Thank you very much for, yes, I'd like, first of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me to speak here. Yes, yes, my plan is to explain several invariant counting curves on Calabrese defaults and explain how they are related. Especially, I would like to talk that some relations between these invariants are described using so-called wall crossing phenomena in the derived category. So let me begin with some overview. So throughout this talk, I'm assuming that X is a smooth projective Calabrese field. Well, sometimes it may not be projective, but anyway, I think I'm always assuming that X is Calabrese. Complex numbers. So this means that, well, I'm assuming that canonical bundle of X is trivial, and we also assume that H1 OX equals to zero, and maybe the famous example is X is the quintic hypersurface. So I'm interested in invariance counting curves. Curve means for a one-dimensional scheme on X. And historically, there are at least some three invariants, or people may call it four kinds of invariants. But I'd like to say it's three kinds of. So there is kinds of. Curve counting invariants are here. X. So the first one is so-called Gloom-Fit invariants. So later I will explain about these definitions in more precisely, but so here this is just overview. So I just say some names of the invariants. This is the Gloom-Fit invariants. Roughly speaking, it counts some curves with at worst nodal singularity to X. And the resulting invariants are not integer, but some rational number. And another invariant is so-called Kopackmann buffer invariant. But to be more precise, so at this moment, there is no satisfactory theory on this invariant from a purely mathematical point of view. And this correspondence was first suggested by Kopackmann and Buffer. So this is called the Kopackmann Buffer conjecture in 8. So this is a formula expressing this rational invariant in terms of integer invariants. But as I said, so this is quite difficult invariant from a mathematical point of view, and there is no mathematical rigorous definition at this moment. But instead, well, there is another integer valued invariant called like Donaldson-Thomas invariant, or this is also equivalent to so-called Panda-Thomas invariant. So this was a conjecture proposed by Morvik, Nekrasov, Okonkwo, and Pandey in 2003. Right, this correspondence is not proved in many cases. But anyway, so roughly speaking, so as I told, so Gloom-Fit invariants, roughly speaking, counting maps from curves to the ambient Calabrese field, and buffer invariant. So roughly speaking, this is counting some one-dimensional sieves X. So this is something like vector bundles on curves on x. And this is, roughly speaking, this is counting subschemes. So I'm going to, yes, later I'll save that, well, this is also interpreted as counting sieves. So mathematically, both sides seem to be very closely related. But the way counting these numbers are quite different. And still, well, the relationship between these invariants and these invariants are somehow mysterious. Anyway, so combining these conjectures, we should get some relations of these invariants. So yes, so explaining the relationship of these invariants is the main goal of these lectures. And well, this is related to the, at least in some point, this is related to the wall-crossing phenomena in derived category. Okay, so this is the overview of my talk, and now I'm going to explain about about invariants. And yes, basically I will focus on these invariants, and this one is mathematically now quite rigorous. So I will start from defining these invariants. So the first one is definition of invariant. So as I explained here, so the invariant here is counting subschemes on Calabi-Yau C-fold. And as usual for the enumerative geometry, in order to count something, we have to first think about the moduli space. And for this problem, maybe the natural moduli space which we should consider is the moduli space of subschemes. That is classically known as the Hilbert scheme. That is, let us fix the integer and homology class of X. So once we fix this numerical data, we can consider the moduli space of subschemes. That is defined by NX beta. So this is the moduli space of subschemes. Such that the dimension of C is less than or equal to 1. And homomorphic Euler characteristic of the structure of its structure sheaf is equal to n. So if, for example, if C is non-singular curve, then this is nothing but the 1 minus genus of the curve, if she is. This parameter is something like the genus. Beta, thank you. Yeah, beta is the fundamental homology class of this C. Yes, and yes, if we are given moduli theory, so there is the tangent space and the obstruction space. The tangent space is given by the when deforming the curve in the infinitesimal way. So when the tangent space of this moduli space is, so the difference of this moduli space is when is Kohler's book on national curves on algebraic varieties. And if you look at that book, then you can see that the tangent space of this modular space is given by. This curve. And the obstruction class is given by obstruction space is given by x to 1, I show c. But so this is the natural obstruction theory which is defined from the Hilbert scheme of curves. But for some purpose, so this obstruction theory is not good in the sense that, well, in order to have some good invariant where people construct obstruction theory that is perfect. Perfect means that, well, roughly speaking, if you consider the complex like tangent plus obstruction shifted by minus one. So this is some complex in the derived category of the modular space, but this should be perfect. But in general, this complex is not perfect. Perfect means that, perfect complex is, this is a complex of vector bundles. And usually, so this complex may not be represented by a bounded complex of vector bundles. But instead, we can also consider this modular space as modular space of sheaves on X. And if you interpret this modular space as modular of sheaves, then we have another obstruction theory on this space, which makes it perfect. Here is the point lemma. Well, let's consider this Hilbert scheme of curves. This is interpreted as modular space of rank 1, modular free sheaf. X. Such that whose chain character is given by like 1, 0, minus beta, and minus n. So I was taking beta to be the second homology class, and n is integer. But by Poincare duality, this is interpreted as element of H4X. It does H6X, and here this one is H0X. The meaning of this chunk character is that where the rank of this sheaf is 1, and the first chunk class is 0, and the second chunk class is the Poincare dual of beta, and the third chunk character is this integer n. And this isomorphism is given by sending, well, any point over here corresponds to subscheme. And for each subscheme, we have the ideal sheaf which defines this subscheme. Well, of course, the ideal sheaf is a rank 1 torsion free sheaf, and it satisfies this chain character condition. And well, this isomorphism holds because X has dimension 3 and H1OX equals 0. So for example, if you consider a surface, then this isomorphism does not hold because, well, for example, well, let's consider the proof. The proof of this fact is that if I have the element in the right-hand side, then I get the exact sequence like this. But the condition of the chunk character and the condition that X is Calabi-Yau C-fold implies that this W dual must be OX. So this means that where this rank one torsion free sheaf must be the ideal sheaf of some sub-scheme. Must be some structure sheaf, and this must be some ideal sheaf. So anyway, in this way, the moduli space of subschemes interpreted as moduli space of sieves, and this Hilbert scheme is a part of the moduli space of stable sieves. Lemma invites that this is a case of space of sheaves, of stable sheaves. So, so there are these several definitions of the stability, like Jezika stability or soap stability. But here in this lecture, I use Jezika stability. That is somehow refinement of the soap stability. So hi, here I give a definition. So usually the stability condition depends on the choice of amplidivisor on X. Omega is amplidivisor on X. And yes, by definition, a coherent sieve on X is omega stable or omega semi-stable, the following conditions are satisfied. The first condition is that well, it's pure sheaf. This means that well, this is the analog of the torsion freeness of this right-hand side. Well, if for any sub-sheaf, we have support of F equals to dimensional support of E. And for example, if the dimension of the support of E is coincided with the dimension of the X, then this is nothing but is a torsion free sheaf. And constraint is that for any non-zero subsheaf, I have the inequality of the so-called reduced Hilbert polynomial. Defined by the usual Hilbert polynomial, and I take the quotient of it by its leading coefficient. So this is. And here OX1 is a line bundle whose first chunk class coincides with omega. Yes, and indeed this definition coincides with the slope stability in the case of that X is a curve. But in the higher dimensional case, it is, well, it is a kind of refinement of the slope stability. In So the reference of this notion of semi-stability and it's a moduli space of semi-stable shapes or stable shapes, maybe probably to length, moduli, geometry of moduli of sieves. Yes. Yes, definition. This is divided by A, so A is the leading coefficient of this polynomial. Okay, so maybe I should say that. Well, this is by Riemann-Lof theorem, this is a polynomial. So it may be given by A, MD plus, maybe. I'm taking it. Anyway, but later, so yeah, I will not use this definition, so maybe you can forget it. Yes. Which one? This one? What is over? Yes, so, yes. So there is, this is relative to the central charge given by something like this, I mean. So, right, if you consider the central charge given by something like this, right. I think that Alain will give something on this, but well, this is the stability condition given by this is something like limiting degeneration of the stability condition given by bridge lamp. And if you consider something limit of the stability condition given by central charge like this and some hard T structure, then it is approximated by this one. But formally, it's not possible to formulate this stability condition in terms of the central charge, as in the talk of RM. And it, in order to formulate it as something like central charge and something, well, you need to some generalized notion of the central charge, like RM's notion of polynomial stability condition. Okay? Okay, so then, I can talk about the moduli space of semi-stable shapes. So let's fix. So in the case of Hilbert scheme of curves, I fix beta and n. So this means that I'm fixing the Chern character over here. So in general, I'm fixing V. So this is the element of XQ, and we can consider moduli space of stable shapes with Chern character V, and moduli space of semi-stable shapes with Chern character V. These are moduli spaces. Stable or semi-stable. Character V. But in general, there is a problem in thinking about semi-stable shapes because the moduli functor is not usually representable. And usually, when we talk about moduli space of semi-stable shapes, we regard it as a stack. So indeed, so this is moduli stacks. But if you only consider moduli space of stable one, then it is easier because if you say stack, this means that this is the set of semi-stable shapes or a set of stable shapes together with the information of the automorphisms of these shapes. And in general, the automorphism groups of semi-stable shapes is quite complicated. But for stable shapes, every automorphism of stable shape is given by just C star. So this means that, well, this is almost a scheme. So this means that, well, there is a natural map from here to some crystal projective scheme. And this is so-called sister job. So this is a bundle of a, one over sister bundle. But anyway, so yeah, this is the honest scheme, and when we consider the modular space, then we can just think about this space. And later I will talk about some semi-stable shifts. So yes, for the later purpose, I will draw this picture of the stack. But for this moment, you can forget this one and just think about this space. So anyway, so this is the projective scheme. Whose points correspond to the stable shift with the chunk character V. And usually, so this space is not projective, but if if there is no strictly semi-stable shift, then this is a projective scheme. So, and in this case, the definition of the Donaldson-Thomas invariant is not so difficult. And later, I will talk about the case that there is a strict semi-stable shift. And in that case, we have to think about stacks. But maybe for today's talk, so I'm always assume that there is no strict semi-stable shift, and the modular space is indeed projective. Yes, for example, that condition happens when V is given by that chunk character, like minus beta minus n. And in this case, as we just looked at it, so this modular space is isomorphic to the Hilbert scheme of curves. Or so if beta is zero, then this is a modular space of zero-dimensional subschemes. So anyway, the better point of this interpretation of Hilbert scheme in terms of shifts is that in here there is a better obstruction deformation obstruction theory. So in general, for any if I have a stable shift, then the tangent space of this modular space at this point is given by 1, and the obstruction space is given by. So this is again, so this is a standard result of the deformation obstruction theory of shifts, and the difference is Hoybicht Wien's geometry of modular shifts. But here, if we assume that X is Calabi-Yau, so we have some strong relationship between this tangent space and obstruction space. This is because, first, by the same duality, I have x2ee is isomorphic to the x1ee tensor omega x. Dual by the same duality, together with that dimension of X is 3. And yes, and because I assumed that X is Calabi-Yau, this means omega X is trivial, so this means 1 E dual. So this means that the deformation obstruction theory of the modular space of shifts on Calabi-Yau Seifert is self-dual. And in that case, we have good definition of counting invariant. This is due to Kai-Beyland. So he showed that if M is a objective scheme, and yes, and I should say that in the case that if the tangent and obstructions are dual, then this is called the symmetric. So this means that this moduli space of stable sheaves on Kai-Beyland C4 have symmetric, and also in this case, the tangent, and in this case, tangent and obstruction shifted by minus one is, so in this case, this is shown to be perfect. Well, roughly speaking, perfectness implies that the difference of the dimension of tangent and obstruction should be constant. And indeed, in this case, the tangent, the dimension of the tangent and the difference of the dimension of the tangent and the dimension of the obstruction theory are zero. So this means that, this is not a proof, but anyway, so we can show that this obstruction theory is indeed perfect. And if M is a projective scheme with metric perfect obstruction theory, then we can first construct a zero-dimensional virtual fundamental cycle on the moduli on this module, on this scheme. So there is a natural dimensional virtual fundamental cycle. And also, so this property holds if I have a projective scheme with perfect obstruction theory whose virtual dimension is zero. But because of the symmetric property, we have more stronger statement that there is a certain canonical constructive function on this scheme. This is canonical constructive function such that the integration of this zero-dimensional virtual fundamental cycle is given by the integration of this constructive function. So later I will give you some more detail on this constructive function, but today I just assume the existence of such function and proceed. That is that because I'm assuming here that M is a projective scheme, we can take the integration of the zero dimensional virtual class. So this virtual class lies in the group. We can talk about this integration of the virtual class. This is nothing but the degree of this zero-dimensional virtual class. And this one coincides with the integration of this function whose measure is the Euler number. More precisely, this is given by so here E means that this is the logical Euler number. So anyway, by using this virtual class or constructive function, we can talk about the integration of the virtual fundamental cycle on the moduli space of stable sheaves. But as I told here, In general, this modular space may not be projective, and this holds when there is no strictly semi-stable series. And the first definition of Donaldson-Thomas invariant should assume that there is no strictly semi-stable series. So, under this assumption, define the Donaldson-Thomas invariant that is dt omega v. So this is the integration of the zero-dimensional partial fundamental cycle on here. This is a modular space of stables with Chern character v. And by this property, this is also written as the integration of the canonical constructive function. So for this constructive function, I will give detail on Wednesday. But anyway, so this means that this dt invariant is something like the Euler number of the modular space of stable series. And indeed, if this modular space is non-singular, then this constructive function is either 1 or minus 1. So in this case, this is nothing but the topological Euler number of this modular space. That is, so this property can be also shown by this definition, but connected. Anyway, the dt invariant is something like the Euler number of the modular space of stable sheaves. And especially when, in this case, if this Hilbert scheme of curves is non-singular, then the invariant counting subschemes is nothing but the topological Euler number of the modular space subschemes. So I would define I n beta to be the omega 1 minus beta minus n. So usually this invariant depends on the choice of amplifier. But if we consider the Chern character like this, then this modular space of stable shapes is indeed isomorphic to the modular space of subschemes. And the modular space of subschemes do not depend on the choice of amplifier. So in this case, well, there is no dependence on omega, and we can write it simply like this. Well, anyway, so this is invariant counting one-dimensional or zero-dimensional subschemes in X. And well, the object which contributes to this invariant is actually a curve, one-dimensional if and only if beta is non-zero. And if beta equals zero, this means that, well, the homology class of the curve, of the subscheme, zero, this means, well, if beta equals zero, this counts zero-dimensional subschemes. So the example is that beta equals zero, then IN zero counts zero dimensional subschemes that the length of structure shift coincides with M. And indeed, yes, we are interested in the generating series. And the generating series counting these zero-dimensional subschemes is completely computed. So this is given by x. So here, mq is the so-called McMahon function. This is defined by this is in my plus or so. So this was conjectured by MNOP paper, but proven by like and therefore, in the case of beta equals zero, the answer is completely known. And the question is, what is it's the generating series when the curve class beta is non-zero? Indeed, well, in some sense, this is not a good invariant because well, we want to actually count curves, but the definition of this invariant may contain certain contributions from points, something like this. So this leads to another notion that is called stable pairs. Okay, so let me explain about the issue of this invariant. Better is that it may contain zero dimensional subschemes. In order to count only curves, you have to ignore such contributions. And of course, if I have subscheme, and we can also add some zero-dimensional sheaves, zero-dimensional subschemes to that subscheme and make it sub-rev curved, that is, where the structure sheaf is not pure. So yes, this means that we may contain contributions from subschemes after that. What I thought OC is not pure means that some subscheme, some subsheaf that is zero dimensional. Here's an example. Let's consider this example is on non-compact Calabi-Yau field, but this is just a local picture, and you can just globalize it, e.g. So let's consider the subscheme like this. So this is the disjoint union of lines like this. And let's consider its limit. As a subscheme. Then, of course, this grab subscheme is defined by xz multiplied by yz minus t. So if you take the limit to t to 0, then I get subscheme C7 C3 that is defined by xz yz. But it is easy to see that this subscheme is not pure. That is, there is some zero-dimensional embedded point. That means if I take the t to zero limit, I get some curve, some subscheme like this, but there is a zero-dimensional embedded point. So indeed, if we consider the structure sheaf of this curve, of this subscheme, and if we take the subsheaf generated by Z, then this is isomorphic to the structure sheaf of the origin. So the idea of a stable pair is that we can take something defined limit. So the issue of this limit is that the structure sheaf of this subscheme has zero-dimensional embedded point. But instead, well, this is a disjoint union of curves, and the natural limit of this structure sheaf is that we can just take the direct sum of these subschemes. That is, if I set D1 to be x equals z equals 0, y equals z equals 0, then we can consider the assumption like this. So well, as a subscheme, so yeah, so yes, I mean, yeah, I'm taking, if I regard this if I consider the ideal sheaf which defines this subscheme, then this is nothing but is complex, and as I thought, well, this structure sheaf may contain zero-dimensional subscheme. But instead, if we consider this complex, then this is indeed pure sheaf. Yes. So in some sense, in this sense, well, this limit is better because there is no contribution from point from car from points. But instead, the bad point over here is that well, this map is not surjective, so it has zero-dimensional co-kernel. But anyway, so this is another limit of this family of curves. And for the purpose of counting curves, this limit is better. So now this is a definition of stable pairs. So this definition is due to Van der Heijvaande and Thomas in 2007. So by definition, a stable pair is X is, this is a pair of F and S. Here F is pure one-dimensional sheaf. S is a section of F, that is map from O, map from OX to F, such that this map may not be surjective, but it has at most, at least zero-dimensional co-kernel. Then similarly as before, we can consider moduli space of stable pairs. So of course, so this gives a definition, gives an example of a stable pair. But let's define PNX beta. So this is moduli space of stable pairs. X, such that if I have one-dimensional sheaf, we have the associated fundamental class, and this fundamental class coincides with beta and homomorphic Euler characteristic of this f coincides with n. And this moduli space is also known to be the projective scheme. And as I told in the deformation of structure theory of the Hilbert scheme, so the point of the deformation of structure theory of subscheme was to interpret it as moduli space of sheaves. And here we cannot interpret it as moduli space of sheaves, but instead we can regard it as moduli space of complexes. Or more precisely, this is a moduli space of objects in the derived category. That means, well, of course, yeah, if I have a stable pair, then we have the associated two-term complex. This is a moduli space of. Objects in the derived category. By creating S and F and S to the some complex given by stable pairs. So this means that if we consider this two-term complex, and if we consider deformation of this object in the derived category, then it is still, again, given by the two-term complex given by stable pairs. And that observation gives natural deformation of structure theory. That means tangent is given by x to 1. And again, so this is a safe dual by the safe duality. So by this property, this moduli space of stable pairs also admit symmetric perfect obstruction theory. Yeah, it is proven. Yeah, it is proven in the paper of Pandai Pandai Thomas. Hmm? Yeah, it's not a proof. The proof that which statement? Yes. Yes. Sorry, yes. Yes, indeed. So there is a paper by Hoybrich and Thomas, they construct symmetric perfect obstruction theory on the moduli space of object in the derived category. I can define, so yeah, because this is a symmetric perfect obstruction theory, I can define beta virtual. So this is called PT variant. Anyway, let me summarize just the difference of PT and PT. So this was counting ideal sheaves of one-dimensional or zero-dimensional subschemes, and this is not a stable pair. And don't if well, OC is not pure. Well, this is because this ideal sheaf is given by the kernel of this natural map. And of course, this is interpreted as pair of one-dimensional sheaf and its section. But by the definition, well, this structure sheaf of subscript may not be pure. And by the definition of stable pairs, if this is stable pair, if and only if this structure sheaf of this curve is not pure. And in this case, I have the distinct triangle that is by some complex. And let's take maximal zero dimensional sub C from here, and let's take OC prime to be OC divided by Q. And I have this natural map from IC to IC prime. And the kernel is given by. And so, anyway, so this is the exact sequence of the complexes, and this gives the distinct triangle in the derived category. But on the other hand, if I have a stable pair, not ideal sheaf, and only if S is not adjective. And in this case, we can just take the image of this map, the structure sheaf of some subscheme. And by taking Hokkanim, I get some zero dimensional sheaf. So I have also this exact sequence of complexes. But the order of the object which appears are different. That is, I have the distinct triangle like this. So anyway, so if I consider the difference of this ideal sheaf and stable pair, then it is related to the two exact sequences which appears something in the different order. And indeed, so this phenomenon is interpreted as warp crossing phenomena in the derived category. So indeed, they are interpreted as exact sequences in some hard of T structure in the derived category. And by considering suitable stability conditions, we can interpret it as warp crossing. And yes, anyway, so by this interpretation, we can show the difference of the generating sheets of stable pair, generating sheets of Thomas invariant, and generating sheets of stable pair invariant. Difference is given by the power of the McMahon function. It was conjectured by Van der Heijpande and Thomas. It was proven by several people, Dave Richland, Papa Thomas. Also, there is a generalization of this formula, but anyway, so this is a consequence of the warp crossing phenomena in the derived category, and so tomorrow, PN beta, so this is QN. So tomorrow, I will talk about some more property of the generating sheets of this stable pair invariant. So today, I stop here. Thank you very much.